have a completed scientific report in less than 2 days if you can follow these simple steps. Writing quickly and with intent has become one of the greatest skills you can have. I want to share with you the most effective way to write a scientific report that I apply to all my own papers. Rule number one is no editing. Writing and editing are two completely separate tasks, and your point here is to write a scientific report and not edit one. The last thing you want to do is fall into the same rewriting rat wheel that so many others fall onto of rephrasing their sentences over and over again in an effort to make them perfect. And believe me, they'll never be perfect anyway, especially since some sentences or even entire paragraphs may not even make it into your final work. So the last thing you want to be doing is wasting your time editing them. Rule number two is to create a story. So for this, you want to put writing aside completely for the moment and create all your images, figures, and tables. Once you have them ready, rearrange them to create a visual story that explains your entire study. And this story should follow the outline order of a scientific report, which is an abstract, introduction, methods, results, discussion, and conclusion. And this visual story will form the outline of your scientific report and make it easier and faster to write. Rule number three is to follow the writing order and not the outline order. So the writing order is methods first, then results, discussion, conclusion, introduction, abstract, and your title is last. If you ask anybody that's published papers in science, they'll tell you that they always start with the methods section first. And that's because it's the easiest section to write. It practically writes itself because you've already done the work. Whereas if you try and write the introduction first, you often feel like you have writer's block, and that's because it's the hardest section to write. To get started writing, the methods section is just a recipe. This is about what you did, where and when you did it, how you did it, and the materials you used to do it. And it's broken up into two main components of data collection and data analysis. In your data collection component, you're talking about your samples and your sampling procedure. Try to include your sample type, size, groups, populations, the factors and variables that you collected, and how you collected it. What tools, materials, equipment, or machines did you use? Were you in the laboratory, in the field? Did you collect survey responses online or in person? Be as detailed as you can so that anybody could pick up your scientific report, read your methods section, and follow it like a recipe to get the same results you did. Then in your data analysis section, include what you did to the data after you collected it, how you processed your data, whether you used statistics, mathematical modeling, and remember to include your hardware and software, including the version numbers. Your methods section should be written in a factual or blunt manner, much like a Wikipedia page. So we're not providing opinions here, and that's partly why it's so easy to write. It should also be written in the past tense, and that's because you've already done the work. I did X, write about it. I did Y, write about it. Your methods section should also be written in a chronological order of what you did your work in. For example, I'm a geologist. I go into the field first, collect my rocks, and then come back and do some work on them in the laboratory. I write my methods section in that order, my field component first, followed by my laboratory component. After you finish your methods section, you can begin writing your results section, which pretty much writes itself. It's also written in a factual and blunt manner. We're not providing opinions or implications of our study here. However, your results section should be written in the present tense, and that's because your results haven't changed. For example, if we did a study on trees in Central Australia and we found that there are 60 different types of trees in a certain area, we wouldn't want to write there were 60 different types of trees because our results haven't changed. There are 60 different types of trees. Your results section should also follow that visual story you've already created. You probably will have noticed when you're creating your images that the vast majority of them are of your data. So your results section will follow those graphs and images here and tell the story to your reader. Remember that all your figures and tables should be standalone, and by that it means that the reader can understand your figure or table completely just with the figure or table caption and shouldn't need to read your main text to understand them. Remember, you're in control here. So you're leading the reader through the story you want to create in your results section. Subheadings are really helpful if you have quite a larger study. Some small studies you won't need any subheadings. In my work, I use, for example, my first subheading is often morphology, which is what my rocks look like. My second section is often geochemistry or mineralogy, which is what my rocks are made of. I'm stepping the reader through the story I want to create for them. Once the results are complete, you can write your discussion. And this is finally where we start to talk about what our results actually mean. What are the implications and significance of them? Why do they matter to anybody else? Some key components here. The discussion goes from specific to broad. And by that I mean the first few paragraphs really talk in detail about your individual findings and what they mean. Whereas by the end of the discussion, you're talking about the implications of your study as a whole. Why is it relevant to other people and how does it matter? And also any work that might need to be done in the future. What I find most helpful here with the discussion is before I start even thinking about writing, is I write a bullet point plan for myself. And that's because each paragraph should only have one point. So using our example of trees in Central Australia, my first bullet point might be, there are more trees in wet areas. My second could be, there are more tall trees in wet areas. My third could be, there are more different types of trees in dry areas. I continue that bullet point plan until I have my entire discussion laid out, right down to the final paragraphs that are more about the implications, perhaps why trees are important for biodiversity of animals, or that they provide habitats for animals, and why that's important. The biggest thing I've found that helps writing the discussion and writing it quickly is during my data analysis stage, when I had other people's studies open, I would highlight their PDFs when I saw something that was relevant to my own study. Sometimes it might only be one or two sentences, other times it was entire paragraphs. I would then have a running Word document open where I pop in the citation, for example, orrtonacademy 2022. I would then copy and paste in that sentence or paragraphs. If there was a lot, I might just put a bullet point summary of what I found in that study. For example, this study explains why there are more trees in wet areas. I would continue that during my entire data analysis stage. By the end of it, I have quite a complete running Word document of information that's relevant to my own study that comes from other people's work. Then when I'm running my discussion, I have my scientific report document open, as well as my running Word document. I then look at my first bullet point, which in our example is, there are more trees in wet areas. I look at my running Word document to see if I've already read something about that. And if I have, I open up that study and relook at what that was. I can then write my paragraph, including the information that I have from my own study, as well as somebody else's. So I'm immediately bringing in the relevance, significance of my study to other people's work, as well as what my own findings were with detail. And I have my citations to include as well. So it really speeds up the work. And obviously sometimes you need to find more studies to help complete your discussion, and that's fine. But I've really found that running Word documents speeds up writing the discussion like nothing else. I've also found it really helpful to break up my discussion with subheadings, a bit like the results, and that helps direct my reader. And again, my subheadings might be on more detailed things in the beginning, so more specific, and begin to get more broad as I move out to the end of the discussion. After your discussion, you can write your conclusion, which is a little bit tricky because there are two rules with your conclusion. Rule number one is that you can't add anything new, and rule number two is that you can't repeat anything. So it's all about careful phrasing. And your point of your conclusion is to bring across the main finding of your study. Most conclusions are also limited to around 150 words. Sometimes you'll see longer ones, but that's more common in things like literature reviews, whereas for scientific reports, they're normally quite small. After your conclusion, you get to finally write your introduction, which if you remember in the beginning was the hardest section to write. Only now it won't be because of all the work you did in your discussion. You already know the significance, relevance, and general background of your study, and that's what goes into the beginning of your introduction. Your introduction works in the opposite way to your discussion in the sense that it goes from broad to specific. So those first few paragraphs you want to talk about the general background of your study, and why it's important to other people. So for example, why are trees important to people, or why are trees in Central Australia important to people? Whereas by the end of your introduction, you've got more specific. For example, this study examined trees in Central Australia using ABC to determine XYZ. This means somebody can read your scientific report. In the beginning, they can see why it's important to them. And by the end of your introduction, they can see specifically what you did. And that helps determine for them whether they'll continue to read your scientific report. The length of your introduction should also be balanced with your discussion. So for example, if your discussion is 5 paragraphs long, you don't want an introduction that's 7 paragraphs long. They don't have to be the same number of paragraphs, but there should be some balance. Normally the introduction is slightly smaller than the discussion, but certainly you don't want an introduction that's only 2 paragraphs long and then a discussion that's 20 paragraphs long. That means there's more significance and relevance to your study that should be incorporated into the introduction. We then write the abstract, which is essentially a summary of your entire scientific report, which by the way, you've now written. What I find most helpful here is to grab 1 to 2 sentences of my introduction that talks about the general background and significance of my study, 1 sentence of my methods, 1 to 2 sentences of my results, and 1 to 2 sentences of my discussion and conclusion. Now, I don't just copy and paste them in, I rephrase them, but that's essentially my abstract written. You need to have each of those components in there to provide an accurate summary. Abstracts are also usually only limited to 200 words. Occasionally you get more, around 250, but 200 words is really common for a scientific report. A few other keys to writing a great abstract: avoid abbreviations, to avoid citations, unless of course your study is based on somebody else's work, in which case you can cite them, but try to limit it to only 1 citation and no technical jargon. Remember, anybody should be able to pick up your scientific report, read your abstract, and understand it, no matter what discipline they're in science. Finally, we get to write the title. And it's obvious that it should be concise and informative, but the key here is to include your main finding in the title. The last thing we want is a boring title like Analysis of Trees in Central Australia. We want a title that's going to engage our reader. Instead, we could use native trees dominate dry areas in Central Australia. That immediately grabs our reader and tells them what the main finding of our study was. And it will be the determining factor on whether they read the rest of your report, starting with your abstract. Unless, of course, it's your marker or reviewer, in which case they have to read your scientific report no matter what, so you may as well make it interesting for them. Overall, your scientific report will have the structure of an hourglass. It moves from broad to specific and back out to broad. The abstract and introduction are the broader components in the beginning, followed by the specific section of your methods and results, and your discussion and conclusion are more broad. The more specific sections, like your methods and results, are the easiest sections to write, so you should always start there. If you're starting to write your scientific report and need help writing your methods section in detail, watch this video next.